Blackstone presents In Defense of the Second Amendment by Larry Correia. Foreword by Nick Searcy. This book is read by John McLain. A well-regulated militia, being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms, shall not be infringed. Note to listener. Book publishing takes time, and since this went to press, the U.S. Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, Firearms, and Explosives has likely changed its regulations because, well, as an organization, it is malicious, capricious, malignantly dysfunctional, and generally sucks. Make sure you check the current rules. Foreword by Nick Searcy. Before I met Larry Correia, best-selling author, I met Larry Correia, vicious, bloodthirsty serial Twitter murderer. I didn't know who Larry was when I first befriended him on social media. I just knew he tore up silly leftist dumbasses on the internet the way Michael Moore tore up extra-large Supreme Mizza pizzas. And Larry did so hilariously, with biting sarcasm, incisive wit, and invincible logic. I immediately saw him as an irreplaceable ally in the never-ending Twitter war, and I felt a kinship, as both of us do not play with leftist idiots well. We both had waded into the social media sewer with all our guns blazing, laughing hysterically as we slaughtered stupid Democrat-worshipping brainwashed losers day after day, laughing all the way. It was only later that I realized that Larry was also a great and prolific fiction writer, with an output as long as my acting resume, and that Larry was exactly the rare kind of conservative I had been saying for years that we needed. The conservative who created art. The conservative who entered the world of storytelling, a world that for too long had been ceded to zombified leftists like Stephen King, Don Winslow, and other once-talented writers whose works had become predictable groaners because of their seemingly irresistible need to infuse them with trite, unrealistic, virtue-signaling leftist ideology. As a fellow warrior in a creative field myself, the world of cinematic storytelling, I felt I had found a brother. In reading Larry's Monster Hunter novels, you realize that underpinning all the exciting action, banter, and bloodshed, there is a strong, sensible moral code, a code that goes beyond mere legality and enters the realm of right and wrong. Often the hero in a Correia work steps outside of the framework of the law, which, if followed to the letter, would have allowed evil to triumph, and makes a moral choice that might technically be illegal. At the same time that I was reading Larry's books, I was involved in a television show called Justified, that featured a main character, Raylan Givens, who also frequently stepped outside of what the law dictated he should do and did what his conscience told him was the right thing to do. And since I played Raylan's boss, I was the one who ultimately had to decide when I would let Raylan break the law to do the right thing and when I would bust him because he had gone too far. You see, the law itself is not capable of stopping evil from happening. It is only there to punish the perpetrator after the crime has gone down, which means that the victims are already dead, or raped, or had their life and property destroyed, etc., and it is too late to save them. Which is why the Second Amendment is the only thing that makes Americans capable of preventing pure evil from victimizing them. A law will not and cannot do it. There are laws against murder. Murders still happen. Same with rape, armed robbery, breaking and entering, car theft, and on and on. The only thing a law can do is punish a criminal after an innocent has been victimized. And in Democrat-run cities with no cash bail and corrupt prosecutors, the law won't even do that. The Democrats, and some leftist Republicans, who are pushing all these gun laws, know this. They know that all the gun laws they can dream up will apply only to people who obey them. Criminals, by definition, will not obey laws. So why are they doing it when they know it won't stop criminals. This may come as a shock to you, and it may not, but the anti-gun people are not concerned about criminals. They really don't care what the lawbreakers do, and when you see them drooling over every mass shooting before the bodies are even identified as just another opportunity to advance their agenda, they prove that. Their hysterical gun laws are targeted with a laser focus only at law-abiding gun owners. The red dots from the infrared sights on the anti-gunners' figurative AR-15s, which they stupidly still think stands for Assault Rifle 15, will never be on the chests of the mass shooters, or the serial killers, or the armed robbers, or rapists, or pedophiles, but solely on their true prey, the legal American gun owners who believe in the right to self-defense, the right to bear arms, and the right to protect their families, their properties, and themselves with force. Because the ultimate goal of the left is to outlaw self-defense. They want you unable to defend your life with deadly force, even when a criminal is coming for your life with deadly force. Why? Because then they know you will be totally dependent for your safety, for your health care, for your food, for every single thing that makes you able to exist on the totalitarian government that they intend to install. Think I'm exaggerating? Leftists have done this all over the world, in North Korea, in Cuba, in Venezuela, in the USSR, and now even in Australia, England, and Canada. And they will do it here, if we let them. Larry Correia understands this, and he imbues his fiction with this powerful idea. And that is why it has resonated with so many throughout the world. Because, unlike leftist fiction, it makes sense. And now, he has turned his sights on a non-fictional defense of the Second Amendment. I want the whole world to listen to it. Like Larry's fiction, this book will knock you on your ass, make you laugh, and steal your resolve to never let the good, law-abiding people of this nation become disarmed and helpless in the face of government tyranny. I am proud to stand with Larry Correia in defending the Second Amendment, and when you listen to this book, you will be too. Bring it on. Nick Searcy, July 23rd, 2022. Chapter 1. Guns and Vultures. Every time there is a mass murder event, the vultures launch. It's fascinating, in a sickening way. A bunch of people get killed, and within minutes, the same crew of anti-gun zealots shows up all over the news and social media, pushing the same tired proposals that we've either tried before or logic tells us simply can't work. With zero hesitation, they strike while the iron is hot, trying to push through legislation before there can be any coherent thought about the repercussions. We've seen this over and over and over again. We saw them succeed in England. We saw them succeed in Australia and New Zealand. We've seen it succeed here before. Yet when anyone from my side responds to these ghouls, then we're shouted at that we're insensitive, and how dare we speak about politics in this moment of tragedy. We should just shut our stupid mouths out of respect for the dead, while they are free to promote policies that will simply lead to a higher body count next time. If gun rights organizations say something, they are bloodthirsty monsters, and if they don't say anything, then their silence is damning guilt. It is hypocritical in the extreme. And when I speak out against this, I'm called every name in the book. They say I want dead children in schools and malls, or they wish death upon my family. If I focus on logic or rationality, I'm a cold-hearted monster. If I become angry because they are promoting policies that are flawed and will accomplish the exact opposite of their stated goals, then I am a horrible person for being angry. Perhaps I shouldn't be allowed to own guns at all. The vultures never hesitate to lie or emotionally manipulate decent, well-meaning people who just want to keep their communities safe. They prey on the public's good intentions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.